Good morning. We are continuing with surgery and surgical nursing, and today we are looking at the types of surgery that a patient can undergo. I'm Mrs. Daka. So let's move on to the object. So basically today we are looking at the types of surgery that are based on urgency, degree of risk, and purpose. So this is the knowledge that I want you to acquire and to understand as we look through this lesson. Let's move on. This is just a picture showing how an operation is done. You can look at the surgeon who is doing the procedure, and there's another person who's assisting this surgeon who's holding on to some of the tubes, and you also see another third person watching and participating in the surgery. So basically when you go to theater, this is what you are going to see when an operation is taking place. Let's move on. Let's look at the types of surgery. So surgical procedures are classified into three. The first one is according to their urgency. How urgent is the operation? Then number two is the degree of risk of surgery. How much is the patient at risk if we don't do this operation? Then the third one is the purpose of surgery, meaning why do we want to do this operation? So these are the three categories that we are going to look at as we look at the different types of surgery. Let's start with the basis of urgency. How urgent are the operation that we need to do? So based on the urgency, surgery can be classified in three parts. It can be classified as elective surgery, urgent surgery, and emergency surgery. So we now look at the details of each one of these types of surgery and see how far they are in their urgency, or how urgent are they as we want to do the operation on the patient. So let's look at elective surgery. Elective surgery simply means it's a pre-planned surgery. The patient comes to the hospital, they present their problem, you make a diagnosis, and then you plan when the operation can be done. So this is because of the planning. It is not really an emergency. It takes time. You can plan to have this kind of operation even for 1 year or 2 years in advance. You have planned that in such a month, on such a day, you are going to have an operation, because the operation is not necessarily for emergency. And when you delay, it has no ill effects on the patient. So it can be rescheduled for the patient, and it can wait while the patient is ready to have the surgery. So the purpose of elective surgery is to remove or to repair a body part, or to restore function, or just to improve health or improve self-concept. For example, plastic surgery. If you feel your face is not looking as what you wish, you plan to have it adjusted, but it is not an emergency. It can wait. So it can be scheduled at the time when it is convenient. The other examples for elective surgery are when you are having problems with your tonsils. This is an operation which we call tonsillectomy. Remember the ectomy words that we talked about. This is one of them where it can wait because it is not an emergency. Hernia is one of the operations that can wait. Cataract extraction, it's one of the surgeries that can wait. Hemorrhoidectomy, I remember we talked about ectomy, so it is removal of hemorrhoids. The other name for hemorrhoids are piles, which we talked about. So whatever the procedure is, it means in elective surgery, it is not an emergency. This kind of operation can wait. Let's move on. So elective surgery can also be subdivided into three other categories. It can be required, it can be selective, and it can be optional. So let's look at these subdivisions of elective surgery. When we talk about required surgery, it means that this patient is having an illness which is serious and it needs correction, but it can be scheduled, it can wait. It can wait for weeks, it can wait for months, because it is required, you need it, because it is giving you a problem, but it is not an emergency, so it is waiting. You require surgery. The examples are if you are having a problem with the gallbladder, if you are having cataract, if you are having bone deformities, or you are having tonsils that are inflamed, or adenoids. Remember we talked about adenoids as lymph nodes that are in the nasal cavity that are giving you a problem, but they can wait because it is not an emergency. Let's move on to the next one. The other type of elective surgery is what we call selective surgery, where it is not really a threat to your health. The patient needs that surgery to correct or to improve the comfort and the emotional health, but basically you can choose to have it or you can choose not to have it. For example, the congenital defects where you are having a cleft lip or a cleft palate, meaning there are those people who are born with part of the lip, the upper part of the lip is missing, or the upper part of the palate is missing. So because it is missing, they can do without it. But for cosmetic reasons, for emotional reasons, to improve comfort, they will need the surgery so that they can be able to improve their comfort, to improve their emotions. So we need to do this kind of surgery. They choose. That's why it is called selective surgery. Let's move on. The third one is what we call optional surgery. Optional surgery is basically for cosmetic reason. You are going to have this part of the body or this problem removed just to improve your outlook, because even if they are not removed, they are not an issue in your health. For example, warts. Warts in our local language, I'm not sure. These are overgrowths that we see on the skin. When you have them, they are just going to give you the discomfort. They are not painful. They are not itchy. They don't give you any physical problem. But because there are so many, you wish to remove them so that you can improve your appearance. The other example for optional surgery is when you are in a country like the developed countries, where they will tell you as a female you need to have big breasts for you to look beautiful. So you discover that this person decides to go for surgery so that the breasts can be bigger than their normal shape. So this basically is optional surgery, because you just want it to be done. But if it is not done, it has no effect on the person. Or you want your nose to be reshaped because you feel you need a longer nose, or you need to remove the wrinkles, or you need to remove this part of the body that doesn't look nice to you. All these things are called optional surgery. Let's move on. The other type of surgery that we talked about is urgent surgery. Remember, we talked about elective surgery. Now we are looking at urgent surgery. Urgent surgery is when it is necessary to do this operation. It is not yet an emergency, but it is necessary. You just have to do it because you want to prevent further damage. Okay, so for example, is when you want to remove the gallbladder because it is giving you problems and it is causing you further damage. That's why we want to do this surgery. The other example is when we are doing a coronary artery bypass. It is not urgent, but your artery has been blocked, and then you just want it to be bypassed so that you improve that part of the body where that growth is coming from. Let's move on. The third part of surgery, the third type of surgery, is what we call emergency surgery. This is where the operation has to be done immediately. It is a must. It has no option. It has to be done without delay, because we need to preserve the life of a patient. Therefore, we need to remove or to repair or to restore or to improve life immediately. If we don't do it, we are going to lose this patient. So these are conditions like when a patient is bleeding, when a patient is involved in a road traffic accident, and when a patient is having a perforated ulcer, or when a patient is having an intestinal obstruction, or the trachea is obstructed, or this woman has failed to deliver physically, therefore they need to go for caesar, which we call caesarean section, so that we save the life of the mother, we also save the life of the baby. So this is emergency surgery. Let's move on. The other type of surgery that we talked about is surgery that is based on the degree of risk or the seriousness, meaning how serious is this operation that we want to do. So it can be a major operation or a minor operation. If it is a major operation, then it is a serious operation. If it is a minor operation, then it is less serious. But this can also be urgent or elective or emergency. Let's move on. So, major surgery involves a big area or a big part of the body that surgery has to be done so that we reduce on the risks of the well-being of the patient. This type of surgery needs hospitalization and it is life-threatening. And because it is a major one, it is a big operation, it has a lot of post-operative complications. So this is important and we need to do this kind of surgery immediately. Let's move on. Major surgery can be elective, urgent, or it can be an emergency. This is what I've already talked about. For example, if the patient is going for removal of the kidney, which we call nephrectomy. When you are going to lose one kidney, it means it is a major operation. But depending on what is causing that kidney to be removed, it can be elective, it can be urgent, and it can be an emergency. So it will depend on what is causing that kidney to be removed. When we talk about cholecystectomy, we are only talking about removal of the gallbladder. It can be urgent, it can be emergency, and it can be elective surgery. It's the same with the colostomy. It can also be the same with hysterectomy. And I remember I explained these two words in the previous lesson. Let's move on. Let's talk about minor surgery. Minor surgery is basically elective surgery. It is usually brief and it has low risks and it has few complications. It can be performed in a clinic, it can be done in the outpatient clinic, or it can be done in a minor operation theater. This can be like a tooth extraction, when we are removing a tooth, when we are removing warts, or when they want to do a skin biopsy, or they just want to do check what is happening within your abdomen, within the intestines. This is what we call laparoscopy. Or sometimes maybe you had a problem with your bleeding in the uterus, or you got pregnant and then there were some some products of the pregnancy that remained in the uterus. So you go to the theater and then they go and remove the remaining parts of the pregnancy, which we call dilatation and curettage. Let's move on. This other surgery is now based on the purpose of surgery. Why are we doing this surgery? Is it for diagnosis? Do we want to make a diagnosis? If we want to make a diagnosis, then we call it diagnostic surgery. So I'll be explaining each one of them as we go down. So it can be diagnostic, ablative, palliative, reconstructive, transplant, and constructive. So let's look at each one of them one by one. Diagnostic surgery. This is surgery where we want to find out. You allow the surgeon, you allow the doctor to find out and make a diagnosis. They will remove the part of the tissue and take it for tests so that we make a diagnosis. We find out what is causing this problem on this patient. This is what we call diagnostic surgery or diagnostic operation. Let's move on. Ablative surgery. This is where we are going to remove the diseased part of the body. For example, if you are having a problem with the appendix, we are going to remove the whole appendix so that we help you. That diseased part of the body is removed and we leave you with the health part of the body that is not diseased. This is similar to the thyroid. Sometimes when they remove part of the thyroid, which we call subtotal thyroidectomy, remember the word ectomy, or where you see the ectomy, it means they are removing that part of the body. Sometimes we also do what we call amputation, where we remove the limb, which could be the hand or the leg or the finger, the toe. All these are called ablative surgery. Let's move on. Palliative surgery. This is surgery that is done to reduce or to relieve the intense sickness or disease that is giving this patient so much symptoms that they are failing to have comfort. So we are not going to cure the disease when we take you for this operation. We are not going to remove the disease. We are not going to remove the diseased part. But what will happen is we will just reduce the suffering that you are going to go through because of the problem that you are having. Remember what we talked about on the aims of surgery. So this is what you can find in the example for colostomy, where the person is having cancer in the colon and they cannot go to the toilet. So we will remove part of the colon onto the abdomen, where we are allowing this patient going to the toilet using that part of the body which we have moved to the abdomen, instead of this patient suffering, failing to go to the toilet because the area where they are supposed to go to the toilet where, in the normal way, it has been blocked. Sometimes we also do that for tissue that have died. When that tissue has died, we remove it so that we help this patient have a better life. And this is what we call debridement of necrotic tissue. Remember, we looked at the word necrosis. Debridement simply means we are removing that dead part of the organ. Let's move on. Reconstructive surgery. This is where an operation is done to restore the function of a body part that has been failing to function or that has gone through trauma, so that we can improve the self-concept. This is the time you look at maybe a patient having a scar, and the scar is so big, and all they need is have that scar redone so that it gives the patient a better image. Or sometimes this is what we also call plastic surgery, where we just improve, reconstruct that part of the body that the patient is failing to cope up with. It's similar, maybe like a patient has burns. There's a very big part of the body that has been bent and the skin has been moved out. So we look for skin from elsewhere and then put it on top of that bent area so that the image of this patient who is having these burns can improve. The other example that we are having here is where a patient is having a fracture and we want to repair that fracture. Or the patient, as I said, wants the breast to become bigger than normal, so the patient will go for the operation so that we reconstruct the breast. So let's move on. The other type of surgery is what we call transplant surgery, where we replace the organ. We get a diseased organ, remove it, throw it away, and pick another organ from somewhere or from somebody or from the organ bank, and then we give it to the person who needs it. This is a common operation that is done for kidneys or for the cornea in the eye, for the liver, for the heart, for the joint. These are surgeries that are done where we move one part that is diseased, throw it away, and get a new one from somewhere and give it to the one who needed or who had a diseased one and they need a new one for them to continue functioning. Let's move on. The last type of surgery that we are looking at is reconstructive surgery. This is where we are now making what was not there. We perform an operation and make something that is similar to what is not there, and then we put it there so that this person can have that part of the body to function. We can give an example of the cleft palate or the cleft lip that we talked about. Or sometimes a person is born with a hole in a heart. And when this hole is there, which was supposed to be closed at birth, it is not closed. what we say is this patient has a hole in the heart and we need to go and close that hole. And remember, in your anatomy and physiology for cardiovascular system, the atrium and the ventricles, so that atrium may have a hole, which we call a defect, or the ventricles may have a defect, and this has to be closed physically by operation. This is what we call constructive surgery. Let's move on. The following slides are now just showing you how you can compare elective surgery and emergent surgery. What do we do? In the area of preparation, in emergent surgery, there is no time for history taking. While in elective surgery, we have all the time to get all the history. We can talk about the history of the patient, the social history, the environmental history, the family history, the past medical history, the present medical history. Whilst in emergent surgery, there is very limited time. You only get relevant history for you to have the patient be prepared for surgery. Let's move on. As we compare the emergent and elective surgery, you also see that in emergent surgery, we spend a lot of time resuscitating the patient so that we prepare the patient to survive and to have life, because their life is threatened. Whilst in elective surgery, the patient does not need resuscitation. They have a lot of time to prepare for surgery. They have a lot of time to take medication, to correct the nutritional status. Whilst in emergent surgery, this patient has no time to correct any anomalies that the patient is having. Let's move on. In emergent surgery, psychological care is given to the patient while the patient is being prepared for surgery. And this is when the patient is conscious, because there are times the patient is losing consciousness and you only talk to the relatives. Whilst in elective surgery, psychological care will be planned. The doctor will come, the nurse will come, the anesthetist will come, or any other paramedic that needs to be involved with this patient can come and give psychological care to the patient so that the patient is ready for operation. This is also in elective surgery where you can involve the chaplain, or the patient has their own pastor or their own religious leader whom they want to give them spiritual support as they prepare for surgery. So you can arrange for this pastor, you can arrange for the priest or the chaplain to come and talk to the patient while they prepare for their surgery. The other important thing that we need to compare with the emergent and elective surgery is the consent form. In emergent surgery, consent form is quickly explained and the patient signs the consent form immediately. Whilst in elective surgery, the consent form can be signed and can remain for 2 weeks before the patient can go for surgery. So the patient has a lot of time to think through before they can sign the consent. They have the time to ask questions and to consult whether they should go through that surgery or not. Emergency surgery, the patient has very limited time, and if the patient is not ready to sign the consent form, if the patient, for example, is below 18 years old, then he cannot sign the consent. Or if the patient is mentally ill, then the patient cannot sign the consent form. Or the patient can ask the relative to sign the consent form on their behalf. And in cases where patients don't even have a relative and it is an emergency, the surgeon can sign the consent form on behalf of the patient and then go ahead and do an operation on this patient. So thank you very much. We've come to the end of this lesson. We'll meet again tomorrow. God bless you. Enjoy your day. Goodbye.